gotta be careful what you hear. There's a bunch of lies floating around everywhere. You gotta be careful what you read. There's a campaign, a lying campaign, it seems, going on all over the place. Just stir up people. You have elements that have inserted themselves. They have nothing to do with either side, but they're trying to incite violence with anybody they can. Man has his truth, but our Father has the truth. There's a distinction in the Word of God between the two. Man's truth and God's truth are two different things. If they become the same thing, that means man has submitted fully unto the Lord. But a blind person cannot have the Spirit of truth. You know what the Lord says? Let me pull this out so you really understand. Because if you think truth is in the world, you're mistaken. You're not going to get the truth from the world. I'm sorry, you're not. You guys could sit there and name a thousand truths. We could play this game all night with that, is what I'm saying. The world does not have the truth. Now, what will you believe, the words of Jesus or your own observations? Because the Bible tells us the world does not have the truth. I'm going to read something that Jesus stated. Let not your heart be troubled. Ye believe in God, believe also in me. This is Jesus speaking. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may also. And whether I go, ye know, and ye know the way. Thomas said unto him, Lord, we know not whither thou goest, and how can we know the way? Jesus saith unto him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. That's what Jesus said. If ye had known me, you should have known my Father also. And from henceforth, or from now on, you know him and have seen him. Philip said unto him, Lord, show us the Father, and it sufficeth us. Jesus said unto him, have I been so long a time with you, and yet hast thou not known me, Philip? Now Philip just asked, show us the Father. And Jesus says, not been with you a long time. Haven't you seen me before? He that hath seen me hath seen the Father. Sayest thou then, show us the Father? Believest thou not that I am in the Father, and the Father in me? The words that I speak unto you, I speak not of myself, but the Father that dwelleth in me. He doeth the works. This is Jesus speaking. He's telling us that the words he speaks, they don't come from him, they come from the Father. He's saying that if you see him, you have seen the Father. If you know Christ, then you know who? Who do you know? The Father. If you don't know Christ, you don't know the Father. He says, believe me that I am in the Father and the Father in me, or else believe me for the very work's sake. He continues, verily, verily, I say unto you, he that believeth on me, the works that I do shall he do also. And greater works than these shall he do, because I go unto my Father. And whatsoever you shall ask in my name, that will I do. Now, this does not mean I can sit up and say, Lord, give me $30,000 in the name of Jesus. That's not what that means. I'm going to read this to you one more time. And whatsoever you shall ask in my name, do you know what that means? Whatsoever you will ask in his stead, in his place. Listen, he just got finished saying this. Believe me that I am in the Father and the Father in me, or else believe me for the very work's sake. Then he said, verily, verily, I say unto you, he that believeth on me, the works that I do, he shall do also. And greater works than these shall I do, because I go unto the Father. And whatsoever ye shall ask in my name, that will I do, that my Father in heaven may be glorified in the Son. This is by no means saying, Lord, can I have $300 in the name of Jesus? This is doing something in the place of Jesus. So guess what? If you don't know the walk of Christ, you can't perform anything in his name, because you cannot do something in the name of Jesus that he would not do. But you can do things that Christ did. That's how you do it in the name of Jesus. Oh, the name of Jesus is an established name. He's telling us something. Jesus is telling us something. You don't just call out anything you want to and say in the name of Jesus and poof, there it is. No. First of all, Jesus told us something. He said, the words that I speak unto you, I speak not of myself, but my Father that dwelleth in me, he doeth the works. So Jesus is telling us that he's not doing things on his own. He's doing it by the Spirit. And the Spirit is God's Spirit. So he's not doing it on his own. In this respect, he's a vessel. Jesus is the Word of God made flesh and dwelt among men. And he said he is in the Father and the Father's in him. He said, if you can't believe that, believe it for the very works' sake, for those things I have done. Then he says, if you believe on him, those works that he did, because you just got done saying, he said, believe me for the very works' sake. And then he says, he that believeth on me, the works that I do shall he do. So that means you have to understand the works he did. And if you understand the works he did, you can also do those works. But you're doing them in his name. To do something in his name is to do something for that established name of Christ. His work is already established in the earth. It's called the gospel of Jesus Christ. Not something that we would make up, that I would make up, that you would make up. Not something I think needs to be done. Not something I have deduced that needs to be done. But to be guided by the Holy Spirit to do something, yes, you're going to do works. In his stead, in the name of Jesus, means in the stead of Jesus. In the place of Jesus, you will do it. That's why it says he dwells in you. Well, if he dwells in you, it's not you doing anything. It is Christ in you. That's why you have that term in the Bible. You just take yourself and throw yourself away. You become a vessel for the living God through Christ Jesus. That the Father may be glorified through the Son, the works are done through the name of Jesus in you. So you're not just creating things you're going to do. You're not the expert. You're not the one that's going to work all this stuff out. It is Christ in you. You had to be moved by the real Spirit that the world does not have. Let's continue to read. And whatsoever you shall ask in my name, that will I do. He said he would do whatever you ask in his name. That doesn't mean maybe. That doesn't mean hit and miss. That means whatever you ask in his name, he will do it. He just said he will do it. He didn't say you would do it. He didn't say he would teach you to do it. It said he would do it. And whatsoever, John 14:13, and whatsoever you shall ask in my name, that will I do. And the reason is this, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If ye shall ask anything in my name, I will do it. So it's not us doing a thing. It's not by the words we speak. It's by the power of Yeshua HaMashiach in us. Now listen carefully. He said, if you love me, keep my commandments, and I will pray the Father, and he shall give you another comforter, that he may abide with you forever. See, this is the part that confuses people. Because they have another doctrine running through their mind, which puts them in the driver's seat, which makes them correct over everybody else, which puts them in this control seat. And that needs to go. That needs to be ejected from your life. I don't have an answer. You don't have an answer. It is the Lord that has an answer. And should he speak through us, the answer still is not ours. It is his answer through us in the world. He says, I will pray to the Father, and he shall give you another comforter. So where's the first one? The first comforter is Yeshua HaMashiach. That's why he later says something else. It can blow you out of the water. He says, John 14:16, if you keep my commandments, I will pray to the Father, and he shall give you another comforter, that he may abide with you forever. Listen, even the Spirit of truth. Now, when it says even the Spirit of truth, it's precisely what he's talking about. The Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it seeth him not. Does the world have the truth, ladies and gentlemen? No, it does not. Let me read John 14:17 again. Even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive. Now, if Jesus said the world cannot receive it, then the world does not have it. It's impossible for the world to have it. He said, because it seeth him not, neither knoweth him. But listen to this. He says, but you know him, for he dwelleth with you and shall be in you. Jesus is telling you something. He just said, if you love me, keep my commandments, and I will pray the Father, and he shall give you another comforter, that he may abide with you forever. Even the Spirit of truth, which is what this other comforter is, the Spirit of truth, the Holy Spirit, the Holy Ghost. Even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it seeth him not, neither knoweth him, but you know him, for he dwelleth with you and shall be in you. Why did he say he dwelleth with you and shall be in you? And then he goes on to say, I will not leave you comfortless. I will come to you. So back up to John 14:17. Why did Jesus say, for he dwelleth with you and shall be in you? He said, for he dwelleth with you, because Jesus is referring to himself. He said, and he shall be in you, because that is the promise of the Father. Because he immediately says, I will not leave you comfortless. The comforter is what is promised to you. He said, I, Jesus says, I will not leave you comfortless. I will come to you. He said that, for he dwelleth with you, because Jesus is talking to him. They follow him around everywhere. Jesus is referring to himself. And then he says, and shall be in you. And then he says the verse of verses. I will not leave you comfortless. I will come to you. What is Jesus? What is he? Besides the Son of the living God, what is he? He is the Word of God made flesh and dwelt among men. That's what he is. Who he is as the only begotten of the Father. That's who he is. What he is the Word of God made flesh. Who he is the first of many brethren. John 14, 18, I will not leave you comfortless. I will come to you. Now, why would he say that? He just got finished talking about the Comforter, the Spirit of Truth, the Holy Spirit. He just got finished talking about this. So why would he say, I will not leave you comfortless. I will come to you, when he was just referring to the Holy Spirit? Because why? Do you recall he kept saying, I must go to the Father? And then he said, well, I'm telling you this and you're getting all sad. If you knew what it meant, you would rejoice. You guys remember that? He said, if you knew what it meant, when I say I have to go to the Father, you would rejoice. Why did he say that? I'll tell you why. Because when he goes to the Father, he can then send. Something is sent in his name back to us. Who is it? Him dwelling with us. What is that called? The Holy Spirit. The Word of God. The Word is in you. My good. But listen, the Word is in you. That's why when you read the Word of the living God, no one taught you this word. You're sitting there reading, you go, yes, that's the way I thought it was for a long time. I can almost assure you, even if something confuses you in the Word of God, it's because you have some other men's words floating around in your mind. That means you were a student of somebody else, and their words are floating around in your head because you heard them first, and then you read the Word. Had you read the Word first, you wouldn't have had those words floating around in your head. What do you think I always tell everybody? Read your Bibles. I am here to assist people. You don't memorize things that I say and start quoting them and utilizing them. No, you quote the Lord, the Word. I can point you to the great physician. That's all I can do. But it's his Word you're after. It's his Word that's in you. It is his Word that you can confirm. It is his Word that will enrich your life, your spiritual life. It's his Word, not mine. Many people, when they read something like this, they'll say, I don't understand. The truth is, because you have somebody else's words floating around in your mind, somebody else's interpretation floating around in your mind, and it's fighting against the truth that's already in you. If you read this like a child, received this like a child, you would just simply say amen. And in time, the Lord would give you the way to articulate it to somebody else by way of the Holy Spirit. He said, yet a little while, and the world seeth me no more. But you see me, because I live. You shall live also. At that day you shall know that I'm in the Father, and ye in me, and I in you. He that hath my commandments and keepeth them, he it is that loveth me. Listen, he said, he that hath my commandments and keepeth them, it is that person who loves me. How many of you love the Lord? Let me tell you something. You cannot love the Lord and have all this stuff against your brother. You're taking a position on the right or the left is not going to work, because you're taking a position against flesh, against something that influences mankind, and that man or that woman becomes your target, your enemy. You cannot do that. That's conflict. You can love your brothers and say, Lord, if it be your will, would you use me to help free them from what has them in bondage? See, we should have experience with bondage if we would stop being so high-minded and ignoring our past of what we really were, scoundrels, public disgraces. We were scandalous. If we would admit that, then we can say, wait a minute, I understand what it is to be in that position. I understand exactly what you're thinking of, because I was there. And you start utilizing that knowledge that you learned in your days of sin. That is, you learn how to speak to those who are in sin. You understand their plight, their problems, and everything else. If we would stop being in denial of our past, if we would stop putting on robes like we're so clean, so knowledgeable, so untouchable, we can actually do some good in this world. But people act like they start reading the Word, all of a sudden they don't want to get dirty, not realizing they're filthy. God is the one that will teach you how to wash your robes white in the blood of the Lamb. But you haven't completed that, because if you did, you'd be pulled out of great tribulation, standing with the rest of them that are already up there. So that means you're still dirty. So you don't have to ignore that you were a scoundrel in the past, but utilize it. Don't deny it. Say, you know what? I know what it feels like to be drawn into a conversation when you're talking about somebody. I know what it feels like to have an ego, and then you lose and you become desperate because you're also embarrassed, and all sorts of emotions run through your head which will cause you to do anything. See, that way you can walk up to a person and say, hey, I understand why you did what you did. And you don't condemn the person when you say, well, you just are just a, you know, you're nothing, you're no one, because look what you're doing. You won't speak like that. You'll say, listen, I understand why you did what you did. I was there myself once. But the Lord can restore your heart. These people out there, these people in the world that are disenfranchised and angry, you didn't know they're heartbroken, did you? Under all that bluster, under all of it, is a breaking of the heart. And it did not come from politics. It came from their childhoods. It came from their parents, their families, and things in life compile upon it. In their minds, they fight hard for the sake of their families. And through policy, they cannot get ahead, and they feel left behind. That's why they elected Trump and not the politician. Many of you should know exactly how they feel. But as you can see in the world, nobody can bridge that gap. And it seems like nobody, there's nobody who's going to have an answer to this mess. Why do you think the Lord sent you? Why do you think he had you among them, had me among them? Why do you think that? So that we could do something, so that we could go to work, so that we could sow seeds of truth. We're not talking about this earthly peace, which is also compromise. We're talking about truth, and not just any truth, but the Messiah's truth. See, once the hurt of a person is healed, the anger of a person dissolves. You can always find a way of peace when your heart is healed. But if your heart be broken and any way of peace fails, you're going to become militant. All of us should know this. You're going to become desperate. You're going to become mean and visceral and divisive. We should already know these things. But if we sit there with a pious mind, ignoring the sin we were delivered from, walking like we're holier than thou, what good are we? We're no good for anything. Because at that point, we lose our salt, and we are the salt of the earth. If you're the salt of the earth, then the earth has no flavor without you. Jesus said you are the salt of the earth. Salt is also a preservative of the earth. But if you are not among those in the earth, what good are you? If you're sitting 1,000 miles away from everybody, what good are you? And who sowed this I'm terrified of people mindset? And so many, the adversary did. Why do you think he leaves many people alone? Because they don't do anything. They're not making an impact. They're staying in safe zones. Everybody wants to stay in the comfort zone. Nobody wants to step out there. You're not ready to be embarrassed, are you? You're not ready to be ridiculed. You're not ready to be a spectacle, are you? Yet we're ready to be forgiven of all of our sins. It's almost like we want to be saved and forget everybody else. Don't worry, the Lord is going to help us with this, because we have proven we can't help ourselves. He has a standard for helping us with this. You know what it is? Since we're afraid to be embarrassed, since we're afraid to be pointed at and be the different one in a bunch, and we normally do things so that we fit in with everybody else, because we're afraid to stand out, be ridiculed, stomped on, kicked, and everything else. And those on the outside are going to find you and do it anyway. You're not going to be able to gain their respect or anything else. In fact, Christianity is going to be the number one distasteful subject over the face of the whole earth. You watch and see. Then at that point, you can't hide. You know what they'll say? Wouldn't it be bad if they looked at you and said, wait a minute, you knew and you didn't tell me anything? You knew I was messed up. Why didn't you tell me anything? I may not have acted like I didn't hear you. I may have been an idiot towards you, but you should have told me something. That's what they'll say. They're going to go to their ministers and stuff. Really? Takes a turn that nobody expects, and they go, so why didn't you say anything? Why did you not emphasize the Lord's love? Why didn't you emphasize that my whole life had reason? Why did you give up on me? Why did you disappear from me? Why didn't you push me a little harder? You watch and see. There's no victor in somebody who gives up. And you know, and I know, there are a lot of Christians. They get in their little safe place. They won't do anything for anybody out there. Yet we claim the Lord has given us so much wisdom. And what are we doing with it? Talking amongst each other all the time? Well, you may do that. I do not. I don't walk around like I have the answer either. You know what the Lord said? He said, if you lift up the name of Jesus, then he'll draw all men unto you. You don't have to go find anybody. They're coming to you. The problem is we pick and choose. that one that keeps coming to you that won't leave you alone? What do you think you're supposed to do with that person? You're trying to kick this person out of your life because they have massive problems. Why do you think the Lord has them coming back to you? But you say, oh no, I don't want that one. I want the other one. The one that doesn't cause all this chaos. The one that my heart is not tied to. The one that doesn't mess me up inside and really challenge me. Give me those. Give me the easy ones. Don't give me this one. He that hath my commandments and keepeth them, he it is that loveth me. And he that loveth me shall be loved of my Father. And I will love him, and I will manifest myself with him. I can assure you of something. If Jesus manifests himself to you, the rest of your days will be altered for the remainder of your time here. But are you noticing something here? Most people say, well, why won't the Lord just give me that moment now so I can just, you know, then I'll really know it and I can get out there and do something? No, it doesn't work that way. Isn't that what somebody just thought? Well, how come he doesn't show me now? He knows that will get me just motivated. And if I saw that, I would just go out and do everything he would ask me to do. It does not work that way. Did you hear what he said? If you love him, you're going to keep the commandments. He said, that person who keeps my commandments, that's the person who loves me. Now listen, he says, and I will love him. He said, he that loveth me will be loved of my Father. Then after all that, once you love him, now this should tell you something. Love is not simply a state of mind. Love in this context is compliance. Love is an action. Love spawns many things. Because once you keep his commandments, which is what? He gave us one, to love your neighbor as yourself. Once you do this, that's an activity that you do. And guess what? It's not going to come naturally all the time. You're going to have to do things to purge everything that stands against you loving your neighbor. That's what most people are not doing. Purge everything that stands in the way of you loving your neighbor as yourself. Some of you, listen, if you're a Democrat, purge everything that causes you not to love your fellow Republicans. You Republicans, you need to purge everything that causes you not to love your fellow Democrats. Don't say them and us. Once you do this, and that's action on your part, you're already showing faith in Christ. You're already conforming by way of faith. And after you have moved by faith, what does the Father do? He just said this. He said, I will manifest myself to that person. He does not do it before. But once you accept and once you begin to walk by faith, the manifestations happen. Once that manifestation happens, your life will never go back to the way it was. Not ever. The sensation, the feeling, the memory of that moment will never leave your mind. You'll know that you know that you know Yeshua HaMashiach is with you. You will know that you know that you know that you know those things of the Lord are real. In order for this to happen, you have to already know. Because all those who truly love the Lord are going to love their neighbors as themselves. I want to ask you something. What is standing in the way of you loving your neighbor as yourself? And do you guys understand what that means, to love your neighbor as yourself? You have thoughts about yourself all day long. If you get chilly, you say, ooh, it's kind of cold. Let me get something, a jacket or something. If you get hungry, you say, ooh, I'm going to search for some food. If you're really hungry, you're going to the store. But will you do those same things for your neighbor? Will you think of your neighbor and say, I wonder if my neighbor is hungry? Let me go see. I wonder if my neighbor is cold? Let me go see. I wonder if my neighbor is so-and-so? Let me go see. I know this election bothered my neighbor. Let me get rid of what I was standing for to comfort them. See, when you love your neighbor as yourself, you live differently. You do that first each in order to do that. That's an action. Once you do that, Jesus says, it is he that loveth me, and he that loveth me shall be loved of my Father, and I will love him and will manifest myself to him. Love is a power, not an emotion. Love is a power that works through you to the world. But if you turn the faucet off, let me ask you something. If you saw a water truck with a shut faucet, and the faucet was locked with a key, and you were thirsty, and there was no other way to get the water out, would you stand by that water truck, or would you keep going for another source of water? I would not stay there with the water truck. It could be full of water, but if the handle doesn't work, nothing is coming out. It could be full of water, but if the valve does not open, it is no good for me or anybody else who is thirsty. I'm going for another source. In other words, if you're full of love, then great. But if it's not pouring out on everybody else, you're good for nothing. But see, unlike a water truck, here's what happens. When you open up that valve of yourself and you start pouring out love, the Father pours in that tank and you'll be an unending supply of love pouring out to the world. But if you shut off that valve, why should the Father pour in you? Why would the Lord pour anything in you that you will not pour out to everybody else? But we must also remember discipline. The Lord has our answer. He is our answer. And he has already paved the way for us. No wonder it says the steps of a righteous man are ordered of the Lord. No wonder it says that. No wonder it says he's giving you all power over the enemy and nothing will by any means hurt you. No wonder he said that. All power he's giving you over the enemy. Not some power, all power. That means Satan can never overcome you. That means you can walk right through him. And no wonder Jesus said, resist the devil and he will flee from you. And he's growing us. No wonder he said we're going to have trials and tribulations because we're working something within us. The devil can't take you out when he wants to. The devil's on death row. He's doing what he's being allowed to do. But the Lord only allows him so much. Enough to teach you, to teach me. Not destroy us, but to change us, to transform us. Thank you, Lord. There's no mean, wicked monster coming over the mountain that will devour everybody. God has given nothing power to devour you. Did you know that in a trial or a tribulation, that is considered you being overcome? But your trials and your tribulations, well, that's the closest he'll ever get. Those are also promised to you, not to destroy you, but to save you. They're working something within you all the time. And you will be delivered out of everything, the Lord said. See, this is why you make your calling and election sure. By checking all of these things, ensuring that you're living them day to day. I've learned something in my little pea brain over the course of years. If you want godly results in your life, then have a godly walk. A walk is your life. It's how you're living. With Christ, that means to fulfill the obedience in one command. And in fact, Jesus gave us two commandments. One was to love the Father with all of what you are and have nothing above him. And the other one was to love your neighbor as yourself. Those were the two commandments. He said, in doing so, you fulfill all the commandments. If you love your neighbor as yourself, you're not going to be covetous of your neighbor's things. You certainly won't murder anybody. You're not going to steal anything. You're not going to commit adultery or any of those things. You'll be a keeper of the commandments. But so long as you blame the other person, you're being defeated by way of the spiritual war. Because while you blame the person, the spirit that influenced the person to do whatever they did has moved on to somebody else, and it's going to come through somebody else back to you. And you're going to blame that person too, and you're going to keep doing this until you have blamed so many people in your life. There's no way salvation will ever be near you. That's what Satan desires. Don't give him what he desires, certainly in this time. But understand the frailty of the U.S. also. See, the world regrets the time that's coming. They will regret it, but not you. This is the hour of one of those true anointings, a true blessing. I mean a real blessing, one that transforms your entire home upon receiving it, one that you can't even comprehend the doings of it. This is one of those times.